Siskel and Ebert. Ethan Hawke and Uma Thurman struggle to survive in the perfect world of Gattaca.
Harvey Keitel's Houdini investigates the unbelievable in Fairy Tale, a true story.
And Cameron Diaz and Ewan McGregor find love on the run in A Life Less Ordinary.
Congratulations, Jerome.
Thank you.
How many launches are there in a day? A dozen?
A computer whiz hot to fly a space mission to one of Saturn's moons pretends to be an astronaut in the high-tech science fiction thriller Gattaca. That's one of five new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune, and I have never been shy about admitting my bias against futuristic movies. They're all the same, doom and gloom and metallic outfits. But the new movie called Gattaca is a brainy exception to the rule, delivering genuine tension in a compelling drama about, ultimately, personal freedom. Set in a world of designer babies without flaws and a security system so tight they can check your ID through an eyelash. Ethan Hawke, whose character's genetic makeup is natural and wasn't engineered in a lab, plays a flawed computer nut thriving under an assumed identity at high-tech Gattaca Corporation as part of his plan to take a flight to Saturn's biggest moon, Titan.
I reviewed your flight plan. Not one error in a million keystrokes. Phenomenal. It's right that someone like you is taking us to Titan.
Has the committee approved the mission? There's been talk of delay.
You shouldn't listen to talk. You leave in a week.
But his mission is threatened by a murder that brings Gattaca under investigation by Detective Alan Arkin.
Two samples, 2 days. Either the suspect went back to the scene of the crime to get a drink of water, and I don't know anybody that thirsty, or he still works there.
I thought we checked all the service staff.
I don't think he cleans up the place anymore. I have a feeling he might be there under false pretenses, playing somebody else's hand.
Ethan Hawke's illegal scheme is that he has taken over the identity of a guy who has a vastly superior genetic makeup, but was disabled in an accident. He's played by a strong newcomer, Jude Law.
You can't quit on me now. I've put too much into this. What do you want me to do? Wheel in there and finish the job myself.
Eugene, they are going to find me.
The other major character in this very well-written story is a beautiful co-worker at Gattaca, played by Uma Thurman, in, I think, her richest performance. Her character's ambitions are thwarted because she has a heart defect.
But we do have one thing in common. Only I don't have 20 or 30 years left in mine. Mine is already 10,000 beats overdue.
It's not possible.
You are the authority on what is not possible. Aren't you, Irene? They have got you looking so hard for any flaw that after a while, that's all that you see. For whatever it's worth, I'm here to tell you that it is possible.
As you can see and hear, Gattaca is both a sensual and intellectual experience, and moving as well, I think, because the world it postulates seems not only credible, but maybe likely, at least elements of it. Strong characters, genuine tension, a most impressive feature film debut, I think, by New Zealand writer-director Andrew Niccol.
I thought so, too. And what's interesting is that the ideas in the film are embodied in the thriller plot, because as this guy tries to impersonate the other guy and therefore qualify to go on the mission, then the investigation to try to track him down explains all of the values of this society in which you have designer kids, and you keep trying until you get a perfect one. And so that somebody who isn't perfect, in this movie they call them godchildren.
And you know, and it's a nice,
nice word.
You know it's going to happen. 100 years, 200 years, 300 years, you know that we're moving in this direction, right?
Boy, I hope not, because it would be really a boring world if everybody was perfect.
No, they won't be.
It's more interesting this way with only just a few of us.
I'm just saying that it's plausible.
I mean, oh, yes, it is. It's a warning. It's like Brave New World. It's like 1984.
Very good.
It's a warning that says we're headed in this direction and we're not going to like it when we get there.
And it has a smart script.
Okay, next movie. And our next film is The House of Yes, a strange film about a strange family on a dark and stormy night. The movie takes place almost entirely within a Virginia mansion at Thanksgiving, which is the holiday for dysfunctional families in recent movies, where a young woman played by Parker Posey is uneasily awaiting the arrival of her twin brother played by Josh Hamilton. He's bringing a guest, and she doesn't like that. After all, they've never had a guest before.
Leslie, this is Jackie O.
Hi.
My mother, Anthony.
Hi.
Meet Leslie. Leslie and I are engaged.
That's Freddie Prinze Jr. as her younger brother, Janvier Bujold as her mother, and Tori Spelling as the unlucky fiancé who has to face Thanksgiving with this goofy family. Things get off to a rocky start.
Would you like a glass of Liebermilch?
No, thank you. I'll just have a glass of wine.
What's the name of the wine?
Oh. I don't speak French.
Who does?
You do.
Oh, that's right, I do.
They're both very good in this movie. The mother is not much of a steadying force, to put it mildly, in this quintessentially dysfunctional family.
Snippy, it's no wonder your father died young. He'd simply had it with all this snippiness. A person can die a slow death from being snipped at year after year, the way he said salad when he meant solid. Two of you would not let it go like a puppy with a rag doll.
Daddy didn't die a slow death.
The central thread running through the film involves a sister's fascination with Jacqueline Kennedy and family secrets that their overnight guest can hardly even begin to suspect. Parker Posey is effective as the chatty, daffy, stay-at-home sister. She won an award at the Sundance Film Festival for this film. And Tori Spelling is very good as the visitor from the world of the normal. The movie's based on a stage play and is probably a little too chatty and contrived. I wasn't bored, but I wasn't much moved either, so a marginal thumbs down, despite the performance.
Well, good, because you were starting to worry me there, because I didn't care for the picture, and I think that the Jackie O conceit, frankly, ruins the film.
That's what the film is about.
But Roger, no, it can be about something and not be good in this presentation. Clearly, that bored me. I thought it was clearly mannered, and actually, the Tori Spelling performance, who you wouldn't expect given the reputations of Posey and her, she's the one that I think makes the film come alive.
Well, she's the one who represents our interest because she's the same person who gets into this situation. But I think you have to concede that the director has the right to make one of the people obsessed with Jacqueline Kennedy.
He does.
I mean, that's the whole premise.
But he makes it. But Roger, that's not really new. It seems so mannered. And when I say not new, what I mean is using that character. It would be like somebody bringing another Marilyn Monroe.
How many movies have you seen with people who thought they were Jacqueline
Kennedy? There is so much in the culture, Roger, and the Marilyn Monroe fixations, those kind of things. Pick some other character. Frankly, it's tired.
Well, why not pick Betty Crocker?
And
maybe,
do it better. Well, you know what? I'll see that picture first before I'll see this one again.
Okay.
You didn't like it. Let's get that on the record.
I didn't like it, but I think that the objection is kind of strange. Coming up later, the great Houdini investigates supernatural visions and fairy tale, a true story.
Why haven't I ever seen any of them?
Grown-ups don't know how to believe.
And coming up next, A Life Less Ordinary, a comedy about a love affair arranged by angels.
We can do this with violence or without. It's up to you.
Oh, without, please.
If we don't get this job, someone else will.
Holly Hunter and Delroy Lindo play angels who are threatened with the loss of their wings if they can't bring together two people and make their love stick in the dreadful new comedy, A Life Less Ordinary, built upon the premise that God is fed up with the burgeoning divorce rate. Premise is okay. The problem is the plot is stupid and forces the characters to be two, including gorgeous Cameron Diaz as the spoiled daughter of a wealthy businessman kidnapped by a janitor played by Ewan McGregor.
Hello, Mr. Neville. It's me. Now, I want me, the kidnapper. Right. No, I can't speak to anyone. I need to speak to him. Hello? Yeah, I can hold.
Here's a sample of why the film breaks down immediately, as the angels want to stay on top of the would-be lovers by micromanaging everything, including their fee for returning Cameron Diaz to her dad, played by Ian Holm.
Naturally, we'd operate a sliding scale, whereby if we only bring back part of your daughter, we only get part of the money.
That's enough, Jason.
No, I mean, if he's cut her ears off, we can't find him, we'll knock a couple thousand off the tariff.
Jason?
The kidnapper and the kidnappee have all manner of adventures that should push them apart, But Diaz kind of likes him, and we're sitting in the theater thinking, of course she has to start liking him, because that's where the movie has to go.
Extremely amusing!
Kill me, even don't you should go, Robert! You should be on television!
Very funny.
What's wrong?
What's wrong is I thought you were going to shoot me! That's what's wrong!
Shoot you, Robert? Why? I wouldn't do a thing like that!
Oh, no?
Great time.
I've been a very big Cameron Diaz fan ever since her first film, The Mask. She is a solid actress as well as a beauty, but the sight of her doesn't even affect my view of this mess. Too many scenes of fake anger in utterly predictable situations. A bunch of good actors wasted, a life less ordinary. I wanted out of this picture in the worst way.
You know, this movie was made by Danny Boyle, who made Trainspotting and Shallow Grave, and this looks like some kind of an attempt to make...
Commercial.
A commercial Hollywood,
sure.
I don't know, and it makes no sense at all.
Terrible.
First of all, if the angels have come down to Earth to get these two people together, why are they then hired out to the Father to bring them back? And, you know, why are they chasing them? That doesn't make any sense.
The story construction stinks.
The story is a mess. The
yes.
premise is a mess. The characters are unbelievable.
Right.
The idea of a kidnapper and the kidnappee falling for each other, it was much better done in another movie that wasn't that great. The Alicia Silverstone film,
yeah.
Excess Baggage.
Yes, better.
Like it better now that I've seen this. This is a mess.
A complete mess. Coming up next, two English girls find fairies in the garden and photograph them in Fairy Tale, a true story.
A little girl in England sees a real fairy in the garden and Fairy Tale, a true story. A movie that contrasts the conviction of the children with the skepticism of some grown-ups and the gullibility of other grown-ups. The movie is indeed based on a true story of two young cousins who allegedly were able to photograph fairies in 1917 and created a worldwide storm when the photos were published by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. In the film, young Frances talks with her aunt about the possibility of the supernatural.
When you get older, people start to take notice. And they don't like it if you tell stories that aren't true.
But they are true.
Oh, Frances, I've been down the Beck 100 times. Why haven't I ever seen any of them?
Grown-ups don't know how to believe.
The girls are helped by the fact that Elisa's father is an amateur photographer.
Frances! They're there on the plate! I can see them! They're really there! Yes!
But are the photos fakes? One person who thinks they are is the famous magician Harry Houdini, played by Harvey Keitel.
Please.
Now, there are two ways to approach this film. One of them is to limit myself only to what's on the screen. And on that basis, I think it's a fascinating, if somewhat confusing, story about two young girls whose losses and worries in their own lives, one of them is worried that her father is missing in action, leave them open to the consolation of visions from the other side. On that level, the film works, and I think older children will be fascinated by it. The other way to approach the film is to consider the title, Fairy Tale, a True Story. The title is a lie, because in real life, the photos were, in fact, fakes. As anyone who's familiar with this story knows, those young girls confess many years later that they faked the pictures. The movie sort of has it both ways, suggesting that the fairies are real, but the photos aren't. Plenty to discuss with the kids after this movie.
Well, you're certainly right. That is going to be the first question your kids are going to have. I don't know if this is for little kids. That would be my take on it.
I said older kids.
Yes, I like the film.
I did too.
And I enjoyed it more for the topical references. I like seeing Conan Doyle. I like seeing Houdini in this story. And I do like the truth of the story, which is that fantasy serves as a balm against harsh reality. And that's what's going on.
Now, you don't think there were really fairies in the movie?
I don't believe there were.
I think there were, but I think, you know, in Peter Pan...
Oh, no, you're right about the cheat of the film. I mean,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, I mean, even if the pictures are phony, I think the kids really do see fairies. I think it's like in Peter Pan.
Okay.
You know, do you believe in fairies? And then everybody says, yes, I believe in fairies. Only kids can believe in fairies. That's one of the things the movie is telling us. Adults don't get to see them.
Okay, coming up next, the grand prize winner at this year's Sundance Film Festival, Sunday, about a particularly eventful day in the lives of some lonely New Yorkers. Our next film is called Sunday, a favorite at both this year's Sundance and Cannes Film Festivals. It's a psychological drama about several characters' search for identity and meaning in their lives. And here are two of the main players. An out-of-work actress, played by Lisa Harrow, encounters a man she believes to be a famous film director. He's played by David Suchet.
I keep reading in the trade journals about all the different projects that you're supposed to be directing. But what are you doing here? In Queens, I mean. Are you a scout? A location scout?
Yeah, that's right.
Why else would you be in this no man's land? what are you looking for? Warehouses? Foundries? Perhaps you're going to get some shots of Manhattan from
looking for a diner.
She takes him home, and he transfixes her by telling her the saga of his day so far.
That woman across the intersection holding that half-dead plant, I had the feeling I could make her mind just by looking at her, that she would do anything I asked, anything I wanted. Normally, I'm a shy man. I wouldn't even dare to look at a beautiful woman, but today...
That monologue leads to lovemaking, which is discovered immediately by her husband, played by Larry Pine, accompanied by their daughter.
Where's Madeline?
Oh,
she must be showering. That's awkward. Look, would you mind just going in there and telling Mad I'm here? I wouldn't want to startle her.
But the great mystery at the center of Sunday is whether this man is a great director or a now homeless accountant laid off from IBM.
Oliver, gonna sneak your lady friend into the shelter tonight?
No. So we have to get going. We have to be somewhere. See you later, guys. I'll see you guys later, huh?
Why create a home movie about a possible case of mistaken identity? I'm not sure that's what Sunday is about. To me, the power of the film is that it examines this character in such refreshing detail that it doesn't matter who he is. He's fascinating, and so is his day. Sunday was made by a former documentary filmmaker, and he finds truth, human truth, in the details of an everyday life, no matter whose life it is.
You know, what I saw in the movie with these two people is that at a certain point of loneliness and desperation, you just project on the other person what you need them to be because that's what you've got to have. And she projects on him, and he projects on her. He says what she needs to hear. She says what he needs to hear because they both really need for this day to turn out the way it does.
And I think that we need to do that, too, with these characters. And again, it's the observation. It's the detail of life. You know, Roger, we've complained for years that films aren't about the things that people really do in their lifetimes and work. And it's all this hyped-up emotion and stunts, sequences. This is life.
When we come back, my video pick of the week, David Cronenberg's very controversial film linking sex with autoeroticism.
Siskel and Ebert's video pick of the week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinets. At the movies or at home, Raisinets.
One of the most controversial films of the last couple of years was Crash, David Cronenberg's bloody and twisted drama about a group of people who were turned on by car crashes, injuries, and everything that went along with them. You either hated this movie or you loved it, but there was no denying its energy and the boldness with which it explored feelings that most people found horrifying. The film stars James Spader and Holly Hunter as two victims of a car crash that claims the life of Hunter's husband.
Can I give you a lift? I somehow find myself driving again.
Elias Koteas plays the leader of an underground cult that restages famous celebrity car crashes with real cars and real blood.
The first star of our show is little bastard James Dean's racing Porsche. He named it after himself and had his racing number 130 painted on it.
Crash is challenging, courageous, and original. It's also very strange, a sex film that is not in any way about any kind of sex that anybody in the theater is likely to be able to identify with, I hope. It's like a movie made by filmmakers from outer space who understood the forms of pornography but completely failed to understand what turns people on. It's in video stores right now in more than one version. An elaborate Laserdisc set includes a lot of supporting material. Then there's the standard videotape version, and because the film was rated NC-17, Blockbuster Video required Cronenberg to make cuts for the version being carried in its stores. I don't see any purpose in watching this film, however, unless you watch the film the director made, so be sure you get the uncut version. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two thumbs up for the provocative Gattaca, a thriller set in a world where genetic engineering determines human lives. Two thumbs down for The House of Yes about the ultimate dysfunctional family. We both admired Tori Spelling's work. Two thumbs down for the jumbled and aimless A Life Less Ordinary with angels trying to pull strings among lovers on Earth. Two thumbs up for Fairy Tale, A True Story. And two thumbs up for the Sundance winner Sunday with its subtle and touching performances by David Suchet and Lisa Harrow.
Okay, remember you can check our votes and hear our reviews of recent movies at our website. The address, Siskel-Ebert.com. That's it for this week. Next week we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Red Corner, starring Richard Gere as an American businessman accused of murder in the People's Republic of China, and also Switchback.
Where's my son?
That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.